please welcome him on stage. So Sebastian come directly from Silicon Valley, and I think that's also the reason why we wanted to hear a little bit about his take on entrepreneurship in Silicon Valley, startups in Silicon Valley versus here in Munich, but also looking at his background in SAP, Uber, and Salesforce, what it takes to actually grow the engineering part of a company and scale it up to a very large organization, which I think is the role that you're now having at Personio.
That's exactly what we are.
So we will record this this event and this fireside chat, but we'll open also the floor for questions during the fireside chat. At the end, it's your event, so please feel free to come and be making this as interactive as you like. And maybe let's start from kind of the beginning. Who are you?
Very good question. I'm actually not from Bavaria or from Munich. So it's the first question that everybody asks me here. How is it to be back? I'm like, well, I've actually never lived here. I'm as foreign as you are to the city. I'm from a small city between Cologne and Frankfurt called Zien. Studied a little bit in Berlin at the time. Studied at the Hasselbladet Institute, HPI. Computer science.
Can everyone hear Sebastian?
Yeah. Do I need to make this louder? Okay. Yeah. Sorry, I got to hold this the whole time. So. Lived in Berlin, studied in Berlin. Went the first time to the Bay Area to Palo Alto with SAP. Got my first glance at Silicon Valley, how things are. Did not really understand how all of this worked. Went back, finished my master's, and then the financial crisis hit. So everybody graduating exactly at that time was like, well, this is quite interesting. I studied for 5, 6, 7 years, and now we're hitting the biggest economic meltdown. So a lot of people started PhDs. I looked at that as well, looked into in-memory databases, some really advanced technology that was in at the time. But then really decided that, you asked me who I am, I really felt that I haven't seen enough, and I really wanted to go to Silicon Valley to see what this is actually all about. So I joined Salesforce.
Did you already see the hype when you were in your internship or as a math thesis student at SAP?
Yeah, good question. So Silicon Valley had always been popular, and a lot of basically all the tech pioneers came from there when it comes to computers. But at the time, San Francisco was actually not the center. The center was Palo Alto, kind of the traditional Silicon Valley. It was really like mobile apps and the connectivity that came with it, the power that you have in your phone today, that made San Francisco so popular because all these applications started popping up and all these businesses in the city that young people wanted to move to San Francisco, so it was quite a move. So Silicon Valley, yes, San Francisco, no.
Okay, so you spent 6 years at Salesforce first as a software developer. What exactly, how did your role evolve over time and like that was back when exactly, 2000?
I started 2009. I did something called performance engineering, software engineering, but about scalability, looking how great, like bigger systems start falling apart. Salesforce had built a social network at the time, the first one, and tried to figure out, okay, how can we make the scale? Fundamentally different problem than typical enterprise applications. And so that was one of the things I looked into. Then I moved to just software development, did a lot of work in the core of Salesforce, where I thought I knew how to code before that, and then I actually learned what it meant to code and not break stuff. So that was quite interesting from my perspective. So I did that for about 2-3 years.
So they have a different way to code, or?
No, it's just that because Salesforce is very similar to Personio, it's a SaaS application. Mm-hmm. So you don't install software at the customer side, you actually run it centrally. So if you mess something up, you mess it up for everyone. And there is no room for errors, right? So I really had to focus on quality. It was a lot about distributed systems. Mm-hmm. And that's where I started getting this interest in, hey, actually all of these solutions have one thing in common, they need to learn how to scale, right? You have to figure out how do you make this thing that actually works, work for like a billion people or 100 million or something like that. And so that's how I got into distributed systems. And then, this was maybe 2011, 2012, Amazon Web Services had been around for quite some time, but not in the enterprise space. It was used for like smaller scale applications. It was pretty cool that you could use infrastructure in a way that could do software development against it, right? You didn't have to deal with the ops part of things. And nobody had actually tried this in a larger enterprise concept. At the time, Salesforce had some challenges around scaling up, replicating infrastructure, automating that. So we did something that some of the larger companies in the Bay Area have, which is you get to spend some of your work time doing something that you believe is important for the company or for your own professional development. And we built up a way to run Salesforce on AWS. So essentially, we enabled Salesforce to automate itself in the cloud and show that this is possible.
So using actually also another external provider?
Exactly.
Which was not so usual at the time?
No. Many people thought it would be impossible because of the complexity of the software. Of course, there are legitimate concerns around data privacy and so on. At the time, this was a much bigger topic. Today, most of the architectures are built on public cloud providers. At the time, that was actually quite special, at least for something that has significant complexity.
What were the other key trends that was affecting this industry at the time? So cloud-based versus on-premises or third-party operator?
Cloud for sure. That's still ongoing. I think mobile was a big thing that was starting at the time. It's still ongoing. Personio has a mobile app. So these things become more and more important. More and more people in their professional lives use their cell phones instead of their desktop computer or laptop. So mobile started ramping up. Social networks was a big push. If you remember, if you were there, like Facebook at some point in time decided, hey, we're actually going to make mobile the great experience, and we're going to push that very heavily and move people from using their laptops and computers to using their cell phones mostly. And so that happened roughly in that time. Salesforce Union Business Application came a little bit later into this. But in the end, I don't want to tell too much about the next job, but the next company, actually mobile, is the only platform.
So let's talk a little bit about the next job. So you moved from kind of more B2B software application to more B2C. What was the biggest challenge when you moved from Salesforce to Uber? And at first, maybe first question is, why did you move from Salesforce to Uber? Like, what was kind of the motivation?
Good question. I would say I got lucky twice. I had joined Salesforce as a relatively small company. It was a couple of hundred engineers. Really liked it there, and then it grew like crazy, right? So it became, within those 6 years, it became a massive organization, and I felt like, okay, this is kind of getting out of the sweet spot for where I feel I can learn the fastest, and I use my skills and get more of them. So I wanted to join a company that was smaller, which at the time was Uber.
Many employees at the time?
I think it was, I don't know how many employees, because Uber is quite operations heavy in the different cities, mm-hmm. but engineers about 500 again, right? So it's the same size. Okay. Same experience, they grew super fast. So within, I think, 1 or 2 years, it was a couple of thousand.
Okay.
So it's a curse, but also an advantage at the same time. So one of the reasons was, of course, for Bay Area terms, I had stayed an eternity at the same company. 6 years is quite some time. Like, typically, people stay 2 to 3 years, then they move on to the next thing where they can learn more, right? For me, coming from Germany, this was the most adventurous I could do at the time. Let me know how this works. Exactly, and then learn, and when I felt, okay, I'm actually not learning as fast as I would like to, and I'd like to try something new, I went to Uber, which was fundamentally different because it was a B2C product, right?
Mm-hmm.
I assume you're all familiar with the app, so it's pretty much a mobile product only. At the beginning, it used text messages. I think there is a web app as well, but pretty much everybody uses it.
And when you got in, it was still just purely an American product, or was it already expanded internationally?
It had expanded internationally, but the US was the big thing, right?
Mm-hmm.
They didn't have any food delivery, so Uber Eats is a food delivery service, similar to Uber, but you get food instead of transporting passengers. It was mostly US focused. They had done China at the time. China was a big market at the time. Eventually, Uber left China, merged with a different company. Very US-centric, started transforming San Francisco as a city, had a transformational effect on a lot of cities, because areas that didn't have public transportation in the past were very cheap, because you didn't know how to go to work. So either you had to drive, which is really not convenient in a city like San Francisco, or you didn't have to go to work, which you were lucky. These areas saw a massive upswing, just because people all of a sudden could live there, be relatively close, and use Uber to go to work, and commute, right? So that had a huge impact on city planning, on, of course, on the amount of people that were coming into the ceiling and were able to work there.
And in terms of a role, you were head of cloud infrastructure, so managing all those cloud providers, which were actually multiple, so not only reflecting on one. What was the difference between a B2B organization versus B2C in terms of scalability?
So I actually didn't come into it cloud at the beginning. That was my plan. That's what I kind of signed up for, and by the time I arrived, things had slightly changed. So I actually did, I ran the development experience group, which was doing all of the internal development inside the group. So building key frameworks, test infrastructure, all of these things that accelerate the rest of the work. And cloud was one of the smaller pieces. But you're right. Eventually I moved into, I built a new group up, focused around cloud infrastructure. Uber being a global app, of course, having a global footprint makes sense. And so the job was essentially to not just move to the cloud, but build this thing that they call the tripod, which was keep your own data centers, Uber had data centers at the time, run on AWS and run on GCP at the same time, and build a stack that can handle all of them at scale. So quite challenging, as you can imagine, but also super interesting. Because in terms of scale, you ask me what's different. Salesforce is essentially, it's very similar to what we have in Personio, B2B software, business processes, business customers. Uber, A, was very visible as a brand. Everybody had an opinion about Uber, and still has. But also, it's a real-time system, right? It's a real-time system, and it was very interesting for me to see what an impact it has on people's lives. So you think, okay, it's a car that gets you from A to B, but after a while, people use it to go to work regularly. They miss meetings if they can't show up. Some people use Uber as an ambulance, right, which officially, of course, you shouldn't, but like in the end, in some cities, it's faster than the ambulance itself, right? And so we got a certain sense of seriousness to this, where like, if we don't do this well, it's actually going to have a huge impact on people. So that was, it felt much closer to customer relationship management at the time, also because it was larger corporations at Salesforce, right? So here, we're mostly tackling SMEs that are maybe closer to us. So I think there's more the human factor, but I felt that very strongly.
Does that mean that in terms of organizational chart, you were much closer to the customer-facing teams?
Yes.
At Uber?
Yes, very close. I would say Uber was a great product company, a strong operations company, and that operations people in every city to make sure that the city works well. Right? And so, yeah, of course, you got directly. Even though it was an infrastructure, you had to make sure if there was any issue, you'd see some city getting hit by that. And then you could immediately see the effect, right? So that kind of gave you a realization of how close you are to people.
Very close to the outcomes.
Yes, exactly. Quite satisfying.
So what were the challenges of that? There must be also some kind of, drawbacks, or like, was everything kind of a dream to work there?
Of course. I'd say the biggest challenge at the beginning was the sheer growth, which is a great problem to have. Business is growing that crazy, how do you make sure that the infrastructure doesn't fall over? Great engineering problem, not easy to solve, but at the beginning of this growth, lots of very engaged young engineers came in. How do you get them enabled? How do you make sure they can actually be productive? How do you build an even better product, right? So I think the sheer growth, I thought Salesforce was fast, and it was quite fast compared to everybody else. Uber felt like 5x faster, right? And I was like, okay, hey, did not see this before. I have to change my pace, right? Because in a larger company, you have a lot more resources. You can do things in a more holistic way. Coming to an organization that is much more rapid in terms of development was a difference. So that definitely, for me personally, was a challenge to see how fast do you have to move, how fast do you have to grow.
Does that translate into you working longer hours, or you becoming more efficient and kind of applying the rule of 80-20? Maybe it's not going to be perfect, and I need to live with this, but I need to move on kind of iterate.
So the good thing is, there's no way to do this with longer hours, so it's the good news for everybody. It grew so fast that you would probably need 72 hours per day to do all of this manually by yourself, right? So very fast to find out, does something scale or does it not scale? And so that actually took the chance for me to kind of really go all in and work for 24 hours. Very quickly you find out you have to delegate, you have to automate, you have to see what scales and focus on that and remove things that don't scale. Right? So that, I would say, was the biggest thing from interviewing, recruiting, to building the stack, to actually how you solve problems, right? If you go out in a one-off manner, it's eventually going to get you just because the sheer amount of work that is there doesn't allow you to do things that way. So I would say it was actually easier because you're not tempted to do it manually because there's no hope for that anyway.
So it looks like a great learning experience, a great learning platform. Let's go back to now current time. Why back to Europe? Why Personio?
A lot of people have asked me this, and not because of Personio, but because of Europe. Right? A lot of people have moved to Silicon Valley to stay there, and are happy ever after that. When I came to Bavaria, my plan was to stay a maximum of 2 years. So if any of you is planning that, prepare that you stay longer, just because you can't see what's going to come at you next. I wanted to stay 2 years. After a year, I was like, okay, I'm going to stay another 2 years. And then after 2 years, I was like, okay, I'm going to stay another 2 years. So I think one of the big things for me was that I've witnessed this kind of from the outside, looking from the US into Europe, and I was wondering, SAP was this one big technology corporation that everybody was naming as like, hey, this is a European success, right? I had seen SAP from the inside, like, it's a great company in its own, but also I had the feeling that, hey, it's not cutting edge. At the moment, it's not the stuff that actually matters in the tech world, apart from its business value, of course. So the big thing for me was like, why is this not working in Europe? There were a lot of my colleagues that came from Europe. I came from Europe. It's the same people. What is different, right? And I started to think, okay, it might actually be the management style, it might be the environment surrounding that, right? Where something over there enables people to build great things, improve them, and make them successful, right? And there was something that I felt that I was missing. So my kind of the overarching thing for me is that I felt, okay, I would like to go back and understand what that is, and can I merge these two things together, right? But very quickly, if you ask me, I had actually not planned coming back. An agency talked to me, they showed me a bunch of companies. After a while I found out I really don't want to work for a just German company. Like after doing a couple of interviews and getting feedback and seeing everything that's going to be offers, I was convinced I really don't want to work for just a German company. I want something that's European, ideally with a Silicon Valley spirit. And I was quite lucky that Hanno, our CEO, was in San Francisco. So the agency was like, hey, talk to this guy. And so we had a coffee, and I think after about 30, 40 minutes of conversation, I was pretty convinced that I wanted to work with Hanno. I didn't know anything about the company at the time. So it was just like, okay, this is good. There's like this somebody who's actually very convinced of what he was doing, very humble, and very straightforward strategy. I really like that. I went to Munich. I met the rest of the leadership team. I met the company, I saw the product and so on, and I felt that this was closer to Silicon Valley than anything else I had seen, right? So at the time, there were the OKRs, and you could see the revenue stream come down. It was a very vocal company and very transparent company. And at the same time, the leadership team was very humble, right? I still didn't know what Personio was at that point. So I looked into the product and I realized that something that existed in the US, that SME market and HR is already covered by companies like Gusto and so on. US is pretty homogeneous, so it's easier to build a solution that then just scales across 300 million people. But in Europe, that's actually, there's a gap. And Personio is hitting that gap. It's actually enabling companies that are not digitalized to become digitalized right now. And that way, enabling an efficiency that has not been there. That plus my experience at Salesforce, which was quite similar, made me actually think that this is an ideal setup. So very short question, long answer.
No, but this is cool. This is like basically where you can apply the experiences that you accumulated in Silicon Valley. And here I'm just gonna actually quote your CEO saying that the position that you held at international Silicon Valley players such as Salesforce and Uber will probably help bring with you the necessary experience to kind of grow, have the right mindset, and further accelerate the company's growth. So I think that's, you were quite aligned on what you wanted to do.
Yeah, I think
with the management.
He was pretty verbal about that from day one, so it's not a surprise for me, I would say. But of course, that's the hope. I've seen two very different companies that have a few things in common, which is the growth, kind of the bar that they set for themselves, and I really like applying some of that.
So looking now at your first kind of 100 days, what's your current scope actually at Personio? What are you in charge of and where do you sit in the organization?
Makes sense. So I run the engineering org, Personio, which is essentially all engineers and all related trades. I report to Hanno, together with the CTO, Arsene, who's one of the co-founders. Mm-hmm. And yeah, I'm essentially in charge of engineering.
And how big is your team?
So
right now?
Product and engineering is together, so you can maybe show a slide later. Engineering alone is about 100 people, product engineering about 120. I just checked a few minutes ago because it changes quite rapidly. So
we're going to talk about this in the hiring
of
plan.
Course.
So what were your first impressions when you joined, knowing that you had this experience from very scale-up companies at Salesforce and Uber? Did you see some similarities? Did you see things that you say, oh, here, I know how to do this?
Good question. So the interesting thing was that my background was in much larger corporations. I mean, even when I joined both Salesforce and Uber, they were at 500 engineers, which is still beyond where we are right now, for now. And so some of the things that I had seen that were already implemented, I did not see implemented right here. Right? And so there was for example, I think processes or just things that are owned by a single person that were teams in these other companies were like, okay, where is team X, Y, Z? I'm like, okay, well, that person sits over there and you have to talk to him or her if you want this, right? And so some things were like, okay, this is a lot more at the beginning. And on the positive side, there's actually a chance for me to actually influence this and drive it in the direction, because more than actually seeing what worked, I saw what didn't work in some of those companies. Some of the attempts may be a re-architecting of a massive stack that took longer because migrations are hard, right? Some of these things that I was actually impressed with the company had a good grasp on it, but yeah, that just didn't exist yet.
Okay. And looking at, again, first impressions, what were the things that you were actually surprised to see which proved that maybe Personio was the right choice for you to come in?
Of course. The coolest thing that I heard, which I hadn't heard before, was the amount of diversity in the engineering group in terms of where people came from. I don't know exactly what the numbers is, 47 countries? 40? Yeah, so we have 47 nations in engineering, so you will have a hard time finding actually a group of German software developers here. And I really like that, because that was something I had seen before. Everybody can find their place, everybody gets appreciated for the work that they're doing. This is a really great bedrock for actually growing this and bringing also international talent. So I think a lot of companies are struggling with that. I found that very refreshing and very interesting.
And looking how to now scale the organization and the engineering part, how are you gonna tackle this, given what you learned from what didn't work in previous companies?
I mean, first of all, scaling is hard. Organizations, stacks, everything, it is hard, and there are generally pains when you do that. But, I would say in terms of what I've learned, I think there's a maximum to how fast you can grow. And you end up in a situation where if you grow too aggressively, you have people onboarding other people and they barely understood the stack themselves. So you start introducing error into the system, and that these little faults are very hard to detect because it's in people's heads and they just haven't gotten with the system involved. And no matter how much you try to push that, there is a certain maximum to onboard quality people in a quality manner. Right? So I would say, in terms of hiring, again, you can try to double in a year if you are really good at it. We're talking about larger numbers. Going from 2 to 4 is not that hard. But going from like 100 to 200 is much harder without destroying your culture. So be really good at onboarding, keeping people productive. I think that's the hardest part. The things that work with 50 engineers are not going to work with 200. If you just wait, stuff will blow up. So take care of it. I think your world gets more complex.
Just go back on the on the onboarding process. What would you advise then engineering team to do? To draft everything, to write that everything down? Because, you know, as we said, it comes from human error, from human brain, what people have in their head.
Yep.
If it doesn't get transcripted or archived, maybe it's get lost.
Yep.
So
good point. So I think one of the things the person didn't have, because it was more of a very old company, was a culture of writing stuff down, documenting, and communicating. A lot was in people's heads, still implicates heads, and that's just normal. So one thing to introduce very early was, for example, an RFC process, request for comment. The idea is you write down what you want to build, you discuss it with others, you pick people that review it, and then you implement it afterwards. And if you make changes to it that are significant, you document that as well. It costs time, and especially in an organization that's early on, that's a super valuable time because you could be building more products. At the same time, and we are in that situation, we have multiple offices, so we have a Madrid engineering office that is also growing quite fast. It's very hard to transport information if you don't have anything written down, right? You essentially need people that understand everything. You need to send them from A to B, and you need them to teach manually that knowledge to other people. It just doesn't work.
And people also leave. I mean, maybe not like the American every 2,000 years in Germany, but they still fight.
Exactly. You end up in a situation where your last architect that understands the stack wants to leave, and you have to throw gold at them. So don't get into that situation. So the thing is, start writing down, start early, try to create a culture of actually being explicit. Also, a lot of design flaws come up when you actually write stuff down, right? Because people will ask questions, they will doubt you. This is where I think an open culture comes in. You need to be able to give feedback, you need to be able to criticize me, criticize the peers if it's constructive, right? Saying that an architecture won't work is important, right? If there are actual flaws in the system. But holding that because you think it's going to create negativity or, I don't know, like retaliation or something like that is exactly the way that you get yourself into the trouble on the engineering side. Right? So I think fostering that culture, which we already have in Personio, is super important.
So not working in silos, but sharing also what you're working on. What about remote versus on-site?
In what particular sense?
You said you were mentioning like offices and how you transfer knowledge and information between offices. So would you rather have your engineering team all together in one place?
Yeah, good question. So Salesforce and Uber both actually had a very strong culture of like trying to keep everybody together. They're partially responsible for the search and pricing departments in San Francisco. that of course has an impact. We're not at that scale yet.
No, Munich is already quite expensive.
Exactly, but I think they were also fundamentally different products. Uber, even though it gets customized everywhere, from an engineering perspective, it's actually one product, and it works globally. Salesforce, yeah, there's some customization, but in the end, customer relationship management works the same way, more or less, in every country. We're in a different situation. HR, let's take payroll, there are APIs in a particular country. It might be written in the language of that country. You need a lot of context knowledge and a lot of domain knowledge, right? And so for us, I think this is an even more important driver to become an international company and have more locations, have a more diverse workforce, so we understand what we have to do there, right? We will not be able to tackle all of Europe with a bunch of German developers. It's going to be super hard, okay? So I think for us, remote work is going to be one of the ways to go. There's also limits to how much talent you can attract in Munich. It's a great city, it has a great amount of talent, but of course it's very hard to grow in a single location. So we continue to do that. We're looking at talent all over the world. In fact, we're flying people in from pretty much everywhere. And in terms of location, we will look at where we can position ourselves best, right? And I would like to do the outside of Germany as well.
And how many people are recruiting per week, per month? Like that's kind of the scale?
The amount of recruiters or the amount of people?
People like hiring.
Yeah, so I think Personio is known for its pretty brutal bar. So I think the company even prides itself for like, okay, we hold that bar very true and we don't kind of bend towards the requirements that we have of scaling. The goal is, again, I said we're about 100 people. The goal is for the end of the year to pretty much double that engineering. Right? And so we're ramping that up at the moment.
Exactly, so if I look at the number of total employees, I think you're now 350?
I think we're 400
already. Yeah. So my numbers are already outdated.
We're 400, yes. So I checked today, we're 400.
Okay, 400. And that figure is set to reach 700 employees by the end of 2020.
Yep. So it's of quite aggressive.
200 in the engineering.
Yeah. So some departments are growing even faster because we're bootstrapping some things. We're building a payroll system at the moment, so we have to scale it from scratch. So some areas grow faster. But in engineering, that is about as much as we can do. And the person sitting in the first row is already thinking, okay, doubling is already a huge achievement. Right? So if we get there, it's going to be great. Yeah.
So next question for an HR company is, how do you organize at scale? when you're hiring so many people, like, what type of is there any hierarchy? How do you organize teams so that they work efficiently? And I know you have quite good key learnings from how Salesforce and how Uber engineering team are organized.
Yeah, so
maybe we can probably switch to the slides.
Yeah, of course. So I can show the organization. You have only three slides, no worries. There's not a lot. So on a high level, this is the team setup. We organize ourselves in tribes, guilds, and squads. This is something some of you might have seen from.
Just out of curiosity, who knows tribes, squads? What's the last one?
Squads, tribes, guilds.
Guilds. How many developers do we have in the room? How many developers? Tech talent. Tech people, tech talent. And founders? Okay, cool. And how many people from Personio? Okay.
Two hands.
Yeah.
Okay, great. So yeah, so if you work at Personio, keep me real. Okay. So yeah, in very short, so this is a methodology and it's mostly in Europe pushed by Spotify.
Yeah.
The idea is that if you look at software development over time, it came from a very waterfall-esque process where everything is planned out and then we execute towards that plan. Not very natural for those of you that develop to what's kind of what can happen during the development process, right? So then you have agile kind of thing, and people getting more dynamic. And essentially what the core of the system that you will also find here is that you build these mission-based teams. Essentially teams that don't get blocked by other teams, they have everything that they need to execute on their own mission. They're cross-functional. And the biggest challenge that requires guilds and larger tribes is that, well, now you don't have any contact to the other teams anymore. So you might just develop on your own, right? So there's this idea of, like, okay, let's put a software on top of that to organize ourselves in a secondary structure.
So is that not reflecting a little bit more of a matrix organization where you have different
reporting? It's not exactly the same. So in the end, of course, different squads are organized in a tribe, right? So there's a topic focus that ties them together. Here, put it to Personio, you have the product verticals, those are the blue, layers.
For example, payroll?
Payroll, recruiting, right? So they all focused around one domain. Then you see the yellow thing, that's product platform. They build the generic pieces that all of these products have together, right? Think about basic building blocks for products. Those are getting built in.
Client login or?
Not as technical as that, but think about things like a workflow engine, reporting, data export, things that several pieces of the product might need, they're not specific to one, right? Mm-hmm. Sending emails, right? Mm-hmm. Core functionalities of Personio data unified in each product. And then what you see is the great part here is actually where some of the magic and engineering is happening, technology platform, that's the thing that fuels it all. Right? And could you switch one slide? So slightly different view on your this is just engineering. So it's essentially cut into halves. Product engineering that is focused around building great products, right? Everything that we do to kind of push Personio forward from a product engineering perspective. Here the focus, I put that in just today on consolidation, because I think that's one of the big things that we're tackling right now. As we get into that size, we're coming to the limits of teams independently building all of these things, because in the end we provide a solution that has to integrate. So there's a lot of focus right now on building these core components, pushing the product platform, so we can actually build new products faster. Right? They don't have to start from scratch.
And especially, I guess, on the data side, right? So that the data flows smoothly between all the different products without being siloed in each of the products.
Exactly. So I think one of the big challenges is that if you don't have your domain model and your data under control, things like reporting, workflows, dashboards gets extremely hard because of the heterogeneity of the system, right? And so I think this is one thing that we focus on a lot right now, is how do we actually get that homogeneity in the system built in so we can build things faster. Then you see the lower half of the stack. Here's everything in there that's not product related, it's pure technology. How do we scale? How do we enable the rest of the company? What are some of the core features that, independent of what product you would build, we need to scale, right? So infrastructure, security, core component in every HR system, as you can imagine. Developer experience, quality team, And if I understand this correctly,
a tribe or a mission-based team would have pieces of this puzzle?
So if you look at this, is easier to explain on the top part. So for example, recruiting would be a tribe. It consists of multiple teams in it that focus on particular pieces of this larger
functional.
Exactly.
So you would have a domain expert from payroll, and then a back end engineer, and then the
front-end engineer. Exactly. So the design strategy. So
designer.
You try to give the teams everything that they need.
So that they're more independent.
Exactly.
How do they relate then to the more the customer facing activities of the organization?
Good question. This is in parts where the platform comes in. So think about how do we build a UI that doesn't look different on every screen. This is something that customers will very much appreciate. Consolidated experience. So there are things that we have to build, right? Key components, if you have a table, it should be the same table everywhere, right? So there's certain things, this is exactly where we are right now. We've become very successful, very fast, implementing these things, building some great products. Now it's about, okay, what are the commonalities? Right. Certain things should not be built within those tribes. And for example, I don't know, let's take a drop down list or something like that that has generic value. It should not be built by one team because it would probably just benefit that team and they would build something specific. Right? So, one of the big moves that we'll have to make and we continuously invest in is boost this product platform area and get as much common functionality in there. Yeah, so that building products will actually be quite easy. You can focus on the domain logic and focus on what makes those product specific, right? And this is not a special thing, you would see this in many companies, but we're right exactly at this moment that where the things that worked great in the past will still work, but we have to help that effort and we have to boost it with the basement.
And in terms of database and do you see a difference here between the US and Europe? The way we kind of collect our data and use our data. And
you mean from a data privacy perspective or from technical storage?
Both.
Okay. Let's answer the easy part first, technology. Privacy is a bit harder. So Salesforce and Google are very different architectures, right? Salesforce classic architecture, Oracle database below there, monolithic, like one store where you store everything, makes it very easy to keep under control. Uber is a real-time system, right? It's essentially matching in real-time who needs a ride and who has a ride, right? So, fundamentally different stack. It needs a different approach, right? So they were already very, very different when it comes to storage technologies. Here, again, we're an enterprise software. We need to make sure that customers have certain guarantees, that we treat their data in, of course, a professional way, right? So, from a technology perspective, we're somewhere in between, I would say. Salesforce came a bit too early. A lot of the cloud technology didn't exist at the time, so they built in their own ways of doing things. Salesforce is building their own database at the moment. It's called Sirenar. Google was different. I would say Personio is in between. We have some requirements that are common with Salesforce, but we're also more advanced in terms of, for example, being in a vendor architecture and so on. Not a hard part of enterprise. This is of course serious, right? We deal with really serious data here. We need to make sure we do everything to protect the data. For me, it goes beyond just making sure that we put a lid on this, like a very thick layer of access control and security, but also when it comes to product building, where I see us as a natural platform player, right? We have that data, we have the customer data, and we have a duty to protect it. So if we integrate with other solutions, we have to make sure that we somehow never let this data as a whole leave Personio's secure stack, right? And so that will have an impact on how we're going to build a platform later on. But yeah, I think that's also an interest that customers have.
And is that some key area which wakes you up at night, or is it like?
Wakes me up at night. If I get to sleep before that, then sure. No.
Is there anything that actually wakes you up at night the moment?
I think the things that really keep me busy, one is of course hiring and growing, it's like finding the right people, right?
Yeah.
Keeping the great culture that we have in this company, but bringing also in senior talent at the same time, right? Give people a chance to grow from the inside. I highly recommend that if you're building a company, build a path, right? But also, we need some external talent, people that have seen scale before, that we can feed into the organization that can kind of help us mature in that sense, right? Because it's yeah, it's a unique situation, but there are certain things to growing fast and to getting to a certain scale that is really beneficial if you've seen this before, right? Because there's some first-time mistakes where it's like riding a bike, you have to know how to do it to do it. Where like getting that knowledge and getting that time from the outside is key. So that's one thing I think that's important. Privacy, yeah, it's a very important stuff to make sure we build the right fundamentals into the product. And yeah, it's a huge concern, right? So we are hiring for security engineers all the time, right? So we're really trying to beef that up. One big advantage for us is that we're fully in AWS. So we have a pretty consolidated system with a pretty strong tool chain, right? A lot of on-premise solutions, a lot of companies that maintain their own systems, and they will never do the fidelity of a public cloud provider, right? Some of the security is built in. It's a closed circuit to some degree that really helps. But of course, yeah, it's one of the top concerns.
Okay, great. And so basically with this great vision that you have for Personio, accelerating this international expansion, scaling in the way that it's secure, efficient, successful for the company, your employees, and for your customers. Is there any kind of things that are, from Europe, hindering you at this point in time, or where you see we're far away from Silicon Valley, and we would need this prerequisite to grow or to be as efficient as companies in Silicon Valley to scale?
Yeah, very good question. We can talk hours about this. What is possibly wrong and what you can do? Let me separate it into two pieces. I think there's the market part. Well, like Europe is rather fragmented, and I would say within Europe there are different levels of digitalization. Right. The UK, for example, the government is online. You can do pretty much everything online. You don't have to leave the house. Right. Everyone's pretty advanced. It's pretty automated. It's pretty mature. But different countries have different states of development. Right. And of course, like countries are entering this GDPR space potentially all the time or anything. So I think that is a bit harder to handle. Here in the US, you build it once, it'll scale across the entire states. There's very few things that are different between the states, mostly taxation. But all in all, it's one system. So you build it, you can scale it very fast. I think that makes it harder for companies in Europe, but at the same time, it's also a neighbor, because coming from the US, you have it harder to enter in Europe, because there's not a single market that you can just conquer like that. Right? Germany is probably one of the biggest countries there, but even that, like Germany and France have different regulations. In every system we see that, there are specifics, how do you count days coming to work, hours, right? So yeah, that makes it a lot harder to scale fast, I would say. Then there is, of course, the question about talent, right? So I think one of the big things is that Silicon Valley over decades has shown people that if you work hard, you're in the right company, you can make it and you don't have to work again, right? So, unless you want to. So there's been a series of very successful companies for at least 40 years now, starting with like HP and some from the garage, that have shown and have let people participate in their success. So there's this culture of like, well, naturally that is one reason why you get the strongest engineers in the end, right? And maybe Chris, if you can go one more. So that would be the other direction. Yeah, I tried to write this down before. I think there are like a million ways to actually phrase this. These are just my own things that I've seen. I was lucky to be in two really good tech companies. What I saw in those was that they generally empower the engineers. Like sometimes I find that Europe is a bit authoritarian in a way, that like the empowerment is not there as much as you would see in technology companies in the US. You get a lot of freedom. Oftentimes you ask for forgiveness, not for permission. It's easier said than done, but at the same time, that talent gets valued and it's in the center of those companies. That's all about talent. Right? So people are empowered, people have a lot of freedom to do this. Maybe when they come to work, some work at night, they don't come to the office at all. Right? So there's a lot catered to the individual to enable them in the best way to do the best product. Right? So I think that we somewhat need to think over. The second thing, I had a bunch of stuff, so I cheated. I put it all in one point. Challenges, growth, and strategy, right? So traditionally in Europe, and I'm going to put this to an extreme, if you wanted to have a career, you had to go to management. There was an end to engineering. If you wanted to somehow succeed, then make more money, have more influence, and so on, you were forced into management, even if you didn't want to, right? And think this is one of the most harmful things to a technology company, that you actually can't grow on the engineering side. So one thing that Personio already had when I came in was the idea that we built a ladder, and we're still in the progress of doing that, where you can get to the very top as an individual contributor if you are managed to scale and to show assets, right? Of course, not everybody wants that, and also not everybody will get to CEO level. It's sometimes even a personal decision how much you want to invest in that. But the ability is there, right? People on the technology side can grow. There are challenges, like some of these problems are hard. Right? I think if you don't have a hard software engineering problem, you don't need good engineers, but then you're also not a technology company. So that's kind of the result coming out of that. So a challenging environment in terms of the technical necessities that you have to build, right? And the third thing that I said, that strategy, so somehow Salesforce managed, coming from CRM, to build an amazing company that feels like a Google of enterprise software. And they did it with like a strategy behind the curtain that they followed over many years. And what I've seen a lot in Europe is that the strategies are quite complicated. The goals are not as simple. It's a very fragmented kind of set of ideas, where this clarity and this vision is sometimes missing. So I think if you're a founder and so on, maybe think like, okay, even if you have a vision, what would be the next vision behind that? And somehow try to at least think about that when you develop along the way.
And having a continuity, so between like short term and long term?
Yeah, exactly. Well, I think in the end, even early on at Uber, it was like, okay, well, this is going to be everybody's mode of transportation, right? So later on, they went into self-driving, they went into different modalities and so on. But even at the beginning, you could say that somebody had thought about like, okay, what could be the stepping stones to get there? And how do we set a vision that in the end excites people, right? Like, think of a company like Tesla at the edge of existence for many years, but coming to something in the end that is almost impossible, that many people said is impossible. So, and I think you somehow need that thought and that clarity in the end to tell your people, otherwise they don't get excited.
Vision.
Yeah. Third one is reward. This might be, of course, appreciation, or it might be some kind of monetary reward. What's very common in the Bay Area is that if you are an engineer in a company, you get equity, right? And if the company then goes IPO, you took more risk, but you're also much better off, right? And I think one of the great things that we're seeing is that every employee in the company gets equity, everyone. It depends on the position, how much it is and so on, but of course everybody's part of that, right? And if the company goes IPO, or when it goes IPO, everybody will see the effect of that and will be part of it, right? I think it's very hard to attract great talent if you don't let people participate in the success, right? If it's just a group of three people in the end, making a few hundred million dollars or something like that when the company goes up here and the rest can celebrate for a weekend, I don't think that's actually enabling people to
get very far.
Exactly. Yes, we just talked about this. So I think there may be many other things, but these are some of the key things that are just normal in almost every company in the Bay Area. I think if you find a way to at least to some way incorporate that, you will in the end get better talent because they will feel understood and engaged, right? So.
And I think if we get the 3 points in our culture, that would enable a lot of great unicorns.
Yeah, I'm sure we'll come back in the last year.
In a year, and we'll see how this has developed. Thanks a lot, Sebastian. I would love to finish on these three great key takeaways. And open the floor for questions, maybe, from our audience. Any additional questions on the topics that we raised, or any additional questions on things that we didn't cover?